part of today because of today's fast lifestyle.
They're simple, yeah, they're easy. There's nothing else in them.
Well, it's an everyday luxury.
Is everybody eats cornflakes?
Why are they often the best?
Because the simple things in life are often the best.
Round 14 presented the Power with their next real test, the reigning premiers, Geelong. And things didn't look good for the Power early on, when the Cats, led by Gary Rowan, kicked 6 first quarter goals. But the Power, as they so often do, ground away at the Cats. And with 7-2 in the third quarter, they swung the game their way. And the Power earned their 11th straight win and moved to the top of the AFL ladder. The Brisbane Lions saw off a plucky Swan side to remain in the top four with a 97-81 win at the Gabba on Friday night. And it was a happy debut for father-son selection Jasper Fletcher, who kicked the first goal of his career in exciting fashion. The Swans never gave up and kept coming, but it was the class of the Lions that shone through and earned them the win. Richmond's yellow and black army was singing in the rain on Saturday night, after their beloved Tigers marked Trent Cotchin's 300-game milestone with a stirring win in the wet over St Kilda. Tigers fans began the night reminiscing about past glories, but they ended it with renewed hope for the future. The team recovered from a slow start to win by 20 points, thanks to a strong second-half performance and the standout performance by Tim Taranto. Nothing seemed to go right for the Suns against Carlton at the MCG, and 29,000 people saw the visiting side go down by 59 points. It was, however, a happy day for the Blues supporters, who witnessed their first win since April. It all started in the second quarter, as the Blues kicked goal after goal, kicking 12 consecutive to take control of the match. It was all smiles as the Blues fans celebrated in the stands. The Cats got their season back on track in the wet of Cardinia Park against the Demons. Although they took a blow early, when their champion spearhead Jeremy Cameron was the victim of friendly fire from teammate Gary Rowan.
They all get to him now. He's a very special part of this Geelong side. His arm moving then, which is a good sign, isn't it?
The Demons looked to have the upper hand in the third quarter, with Cozzy Pickett making something out of nothing. But a 6-goal final term to the Cats earned them a hard-fought 15-point win and got their season back on track. Although disappointing to this point of the season, Sydney refused to lie down. While the match against the West Coast Eagles was touted as a bit of a test, Longmire's boys treated the visitors to Sydney on the Saturday with disdain.
the centering ball. Oh, Goulden comes in from the side.
Isaac Heaney kicked 5 goals. McDonald and Amati kicked 4 each, and the Swans, with 31 goals 19, 205, routed the Eagles by 171 points. The Eagles were stunned.
And the Chad makes no mistake.
It's Patrick and Trevor Nisbet. I mean, there'll be calls for the coach.
Heaney for his 5th. Heaney has his 5th. The Eagles. McLean. From almost point blank range. Check sides it through. What are we seeing at the SCG? The Swans crack 200.
Collingwood and Adelaide produced one of the best matches of the season at the MCG, with 66,000 people on hand for a thriller. The Pies shot out to an early lead and led by as much as 34 points just before half-time. But the tide turned in the third quarter as the Crows took control of the match and kicked 7 goals 1 to the Magpies 3 behinds to take a 13-point lead at the last change. And that's when the Magpies that we know came to the fore, battling back to take the lead thanks to 2 Mason Cox goals. The Magpies holding on in the dying minutes to register their 2nd win over Adelaide in less than 8 weeks by under a goal. In a testing encounter at the SCG, the Swans came out hard looking to continue their winning ways. But they couldn't make the most of their opportunities. The Cats took theirs and led at quarter time. The Swans chipped away at the lead but could never quite shake the Cats. The last quarter saw the Cats clinging on to a slim lead, but with the final 2 points of the night, the Swans scraped in for a draw against the reigning premiers.
A couple of years ago, little one on the run here is McInerney. Stewart with a kick straight up the backside, snap out of there as a point, scores a level. And unbelievably, after everything that has gone before it,
the Dockers and Dogs played a hard-fought game at Marvel Stadium in the traditional Saturday afternoon time slot. There was never too much in the game, as Caleb Sarong and Sean Darcy battled hard to keep Frio in the game.
Norton gets off Pierce. Daniel Eaglehagen marks.
But with Marcus Bontempelli firing and Jamara Eaglehagen adding 4 goals, the Dogs kicked away in the last quarter to earn themselves a 29-point victory. Essendon and Port Adelaide played a cracker in the wet on Saturday night. Port started poorly in front of goal, while the Bombers made the most of their chances. The Bombers took charge in the third quarter, but it was their turn for a bout of the yips. In the last quarter, the Power took what looked like an unassailable 17-point lead, only for the Bombers to kick 3 quick goals and take a 2-point lead late in the game. What followed was a mad scramble, and the Bombers looked like they would hold on. But a quick kick out of defence landed in the hands of Port Adelaide defender Dan Houston, who was a picture of cool and calm as the final siren rang. In the wet, from 55 metres out, Dan Houston launched his cannon, sending the ball through for a goal and sealing the Power's 12th straight victory. In the wet against the Giants at Traeger Park in Alice Springs, the Demons gathered plenty of the ball, but could not kick it accurately through the big sticks. While the Demons peppered the goals, the Giants took the most of their chances. When Ed Langdon goaled halfway through the last quarter, it seemed the Demons' victory was inevitable. But the Giants' Josh Kelly kicked the match winner with this long bomb finding its way through the goals, giving the Giants a memorable victory in the Northern Territory.
And welcome back to That Was the Season That Was 2023. The issue of protecting the head in tackles was a major talking point for the season. Pre-season, the AFL reinforced it would penalise tackles that involved double movements, excessive rotating, and driving an opponent into the ground. But mass player confusion around the interpretation of the rules has led to the inconsistencies throughout the season. Some players getting up to 3 weeks while others escaped without charge.
Still inside the field of play when he started. But then he... Sicily, great tackle back on McCluggage after he lost the footy. Desperation from the...
Dangerous tackle on the boundary line. See how strong he is. He can flick you around.
The Dogs threw everything at the Magpies early in their match on Friday night. Waitman and Norton got on the board early as the Dogs flew out to a quick 19-point lead. However, the Pies, as they often do, steadied the ship and were only 5 points down at half-time. But they turned the game on their heads in the third quarter as Nick Dacos revved the Collingwood engine into top gear. They kicked 6-1 to take control of the game and ran out 2-goal winners.
And now he gets it. Possessed the Sharon more times than anyone in the history of our game.
Looking for Viney.
The Saints and Demons both looked to atone for disappointing losses the previous week, and it was the Saints who started the better team, despite losing spearhead Max King in the opening minute. But, with their kicking boots on this week, the Demons took control of the game and held off a brave St Kilda that was down to 2 fit men on the bench by half-time. The final margin, 21 points.
To be a holding free kick. Joel Smith's come on. Owens has got one back. There it is. The Saints are alive. Under pressure. Neil Bullen's got options in the pocket. Goes for the longest one. Brown. Two Saints fly. Petrarca waits front and centre. It's his bread and butter. Dak Merritt, who's in hot form. Redmond runs from behind.
There was a shootout at Marvel Stadium on Sunday as the Bombers and Crows kicked 12 goals between them in the opening quarter.
7 minutes. Forward they go, the Crows. Can they get one here? Fogarty, Rankin on the up. Keys towards goal on the left. Finally, the Crows
presents big pack of players around him. Right, clever tap.
The Bombers had 12-9 on the board by half time and were well led by skipper Zach Merritt.
Hobbs heard the call. Martins continued to run. Now Merritt, normally a beautiful user, might just kick a goal. Wow!
The goals dried up somewhat in the second half, but the damage was done. The Bombers winning by 18 points. Kyle Langford and Peter Wright finishing the game with 3 goals each.
He goes himself and just chips it through. It's a pivotal win for the Bombers. Essendon climb over Adelaide, take a big step towards finals football and keep their top four hopes alive.
In a testing encounter at the SCG, the Bulldogs started well. But the Swans were never far behind thanks to Errol Goulden and Oliver Florent. The Dogs battled on in the second half and the margin was never more than a few points. Marcus Bontempelli willed his team on.
Here's a chance, Bontempelli, he can finish. Dogs back in front.
And with this goal to Jamara Ugelhagen, the game looked like it might go the Dogs' way. But Tom Papley kicked 2 last-quarter goals,
his last edging the Swans in front and sealing a memorable victory in John Longmire's 200th game as coach of the Sydney Swans.
There are the statistical achievements that back up John Longmire's coaching career and show him as being one of the best. But then there is the anecdotal stuff that players speaking of.
The Demons got out of the gates early in their match at the MCG, kicking the first four goals of the match. In the second quarter, the Lions reeled in the Demons and the margin was only 1 point at half time. Brody Grundy was omitted from the side, but just look at the brilliance of Max Gawn, and you appreciate the talents of a champion. His presence around the ground was immense. The third quarter belonged to Brisbane as they streamed to a 21-point lead at three-quarter time. And when Joe Danaher kicked this goal to start the last quarter, the Lions looked home and hosed. But like all good teams, the Demons changed their mentality and went into attack mode, thanks to the determination of Jack Viney and the straight kicking of Jake Melksham. The Demons earned a very memorable 1 point victory. After 13 successive wins, Port Adelaide's golden streak came to an end against Carlton in one of the shocks of the season. And the Blues' 50-point win was brought about by Patrick Cripps and Jack Silvani, who were dominant around the ground for Carlton and gave new hope to their season. The Giants travelled to Adelaide, but it was the Crows who started better, with a goal to Rory Laird. The Giants kept in touch. The Crows managed to keep their noses in front, but the Giants kept chipping away, trailing by 17 at the final change. Trailing by 17, the Giants made their move in the final quarter, with this Toby Green goal. Further goals to Harry Himmelberg and this perler by Josh Fay had the Giants dancing with delight as they earned themselves a 14-point win. After back-to-back five-week, five-goal game. With their coach Stuart Dew given his marching orders, the Suns dominated the early stages of their game against St Kilda, kicking the opening three goals, while holding St Kilda to just one behind. And led by Rory Atkins and Sam Flanders, the Suns went on their merry way, winning the game by 26 points over a disappointing St Kilda team and gifting stand-in coach Stephen King his first win.
And Stephen King,
an impressive win, but it's been a massive week for you.
Yeah, it's a little bit bittersweet. Obviously a really strange week and a pretty tough week to get through those first few days. So we really just had to keep it together as a playing group and stay really connected. I think that showed today with the way how we played for each other.
What was the major focus? I mean, from the outside, we just looked like pressure, the contest seemed to be really high on the priorities.
Yeah, you're right.
At the MCG on Saturday, the Hawks had four of the first five goals on the board to shock the Tigers, including this sneaky goal to Finn McGuinness. The Hawks then put the foot down in the second quarter and kicked six goals to put the Tigers on notice. The Hawks still held on to a 30-point lead at the last break, but from there it was all Tigers. They kicked the last five goals of the game, and this snap by Liam Baker put them ahead by 1 point and ended a thrilling game.
Baker to put the Tigers in front! The Tigers hit the lead!
In one of the best individual efforts of the year, the Blues' Charlie Kerner kicked 10 goals against the West Coast Eagles in a very one-sided affair.
Yeah, it is. I know. I guess it's a part of footy. You know, you wish you, you know, kick big goals in front of crowds, and it's great. Our fans came out today. It was awesome. My nieces and nephews, I know they're always into me about kicking more, so hopefully they're happy today, and Ed got a goal too, so it was good.
In one of the most anticipated games of the season, the Magpies, with their vocal army, travelled to Adelaide Oval to take on the Power, and what a game it was. The Power got on the board early with a clever goal to Sam Powell Pepper. But this was quickly answered by the Magpies' Daniel McStay. And so it was across the game, the two teams going goal for goal and keeping the crowd of 47,965 people entertained throughout. Ends up with it, gives it off to Maynard again. To the dangerous pair at the back. Have a look at this. Elliott looks about. He's going to give it off. Guess who? Game 200. As the final term began, the Power held a 17-point lead. But thanks to goals from Steele Sidebottom and Bobby Hill, the Pies rushed back. The man of the moment was Jamie Elliott, who kicked two of the last three goals of the game, including this clutch goal from the boundary line to earn the Magpies a 4-point victory. He's kicked goals to win games for Collingwood in this situation. Jamie Elliott, can he be the hero again? And the siren sounds in a heavyweight stoush, an epic, a classic. The Pies win, and it's a 12th round knockout. Max Gawn kicked the opening goal, the Crows and Demons match at the MCG, in what was a low-scoring opening quarter. The Crows wasted their shots on goal. Here by Miller, out in front of Rankin, the everywhere man at the moment, handballing to himself and getting corralled into the pocket there. Sloan back to Rankin. This would be some goal. It is some goal. Isaac Rankin. This is Melbourne on full. The Demons managed to control the middle stages of the game, but the Crows were never far away. The margin at three-quarter time was 24 points. Can he get them back into things? Goes for it and gets it. So Keys has just kicked one. Bends around on his left. The Crows, led by Taylor Walker, kicked the first four goals of the final quarter to draw level with the Demons, only for the Demons to kick away. But again, the Crows kicked back and drew within a kick. However, the Demons were able to hold on and earn themselves a 4-point victory. Across town at Marvel Stadium, the Kangaroos and Saints took to the field after a week of bitter verbal stoushes off the field.
The standards in that joint over the last however long have been subpar.
To be honest, like, Nick's been to zero, really, at the footy club. The only time he came was for free physio. So, that's the only time he was at the club. So I don't know where he saw the standards piece.
Kangaroos interim coach Brett Ratten was looking to get one up on the team that had unceremoniously dumped him the previous season. The Kangaroos were the better team across the first three quarters, holding the Saints to just four goals and leading by 16 points at three-quarter time. But the Saints overran them in a tense last quarter with 5-1. The winning goal was kicked off the ground by Saint Jack Higgins, and the Saints were home by 9 points. In a round full of upsets, 86,000 people descended on the MCG to see if the Blues were the real deal when they took on the might of Collingwood. It was a fiery first quarter with the teams level as the siren rang to sound quarter time. But the Blues took control in the second, Jack Martin popping up to play an important role, and Charlie Kerno getting on top of Darcy Moore. Been huge. When the Blues kicked the first three goals of the last quarter, it looked to be an easy Blues romp. But the Pies threw Jeremy Howe forward in a last-ditch attempt to win the game. But to no avail, the Blues delighted their fans with a 17-point win. The Dockers travelled to the Cattery, looking to salvage something from their disappointing season. But the Cats barely let them touch the ball in the opening quarter, Tyson Stengel stealing this ball from Alex Pierce to score the opening goal of the game. Despite a goalless opening quarter, the Dockers held a one-point lead at half-time. The game was in the balance in the third, and when Tom Hawkins and Brad Close kicked the first two goals of the last, most assumed that the Cats would run away with the game. But with this freak goal by Michael Frederick, and another goal by Lucky Schultz, the Dockers earned an unlikely 7-point win over the reigning premiers. The Giants travelled to another foreign venue, this time Ballarat, taking on the Dogs, and the Dogs were all over them in the opening half. The Giants could only score two goals, while the Dogs wasted opportunities, with 6-10 on the board at half-time. But the orange tsunami burst out in the third quarter to bring the game to life. Toby Green kicked 4 goals, and it was game on. The last quarter was a seesawing affair, but Captain Toby Green's 5th goal put the Giants in front. Both teams had their opportunities late, but the Giants hung on to win their 7th game in a row by 5 points. The Swans and Bombers have played in some close games recently, and this game at Marvel Stadium was no different. Langford with the first for the Bombers, closely followed by Sam Wicks with the first for the Swans. Joel Amati kicked 2 more goals for the Swans, while Caldwell and Peter Wright kicked some for the Bombers, and at quarter time, both teams had 5 on the board. Early in the second, Swans' legendary goal kicker Lance Franklin was subbed out of the game. The Swans began to edge in front, and in the third quarter they had complete control, racing to a 37-point lead. But the Bombers kicked 5 straight goals as the game reached its conclusion, and this Sam Durham goal put them within a kick. Tom Papley popped up to kick the Swans' lone goal.
Papley now, little chance, hits it from 60. How does this one bounce? Once, twice, this goal, Swans back out.
Jai Menzies snapped this goal with 7 seconds remaining, and the Bombers held a slim chance to win the game, but the siren sounded with the Swans 2 points ahead. In a battle of the bottom two teams over in Perth, the Roos got the first, but the Eagles kicked the next 4. Xavier O'Neill with this great snap. The Eagles got out to a good lead, only for the Roos to reel them in. The second half followed a very similar pattern, the Eagles kicking 3-6, while the Roos couldn't even score. With the smell of victory near, the Eagles relaxed, and the Roos started to chip away at the 32-point lead. The Eagles barely gave a yelp as the Roos kicked the last 4 goals of the game, Paul Curtis having a chance late to snatch the game, but his kick fell short and was rushed through for a behind, the Eagles holding on to win their first game in 126 days.
What a year it was for the goal kickers, and despite some very wet and windy weekends, some incredible goals were kicked during season 2023. And of course, not only by the old stages, we had names such as Ashcroft, Cameron, and of course, Taylor Walker kick some great goals. Now let's look back at some of the great goals of season 2023.
Lachie comes back, wants to get the boot on. He's strong, Lachie! He was just too tough in the clinches.
Tom Hawkins has taken it to another level over the last couple of years. Gets out of the armpit and wins, pushes him out of the way. Then has the power and composure. Keep it alive, but the bounce of the ball.
Just won this game. He beat Bay, and now he watches with all of us. Frederick from the angle. Frederick throws it on the boot. It's hanging up in the front. Frederick with one of the goals. One revolt involved. Off the ground job from Baker. It clocked it out.
The Adelaide over early. It's Connor Rosie.
Missed. He says to the forwards, go and create something out of that. Walters got out of the tackle.
Space to work with.
Rampy and kept alive by Rankin. It's Rankin time.
Green, he got fouled exactly where he wanted. Time for the
absolutely fantastic what he's done here. It's a great
think
great
his way through this, Jason. Scoring.
Yeah, you talk about footy smarts, knowing if he.
Oh, that is a big bomb.
And it's drop punt. That's torpedo territory there.
Shot the back of the
scoreboard. The greatest of escapes and the most magnificent after the siren.
The Hawks continued to thrill their supporters one week and frustrate them the next. And against the might of the Magpies, they could do no wrong. With Thin McGuinness shutting down Nick Dacos and James Sicily marking everything that came his way, the Hawks were able to completely control a very physical game against the Magpies, earning them their best win for the season by 32 points. Essendon went to Marvel Stadium, hopeful of adding to their percentage when they took on West Coast. But what they hadn't bargained for was an aggressive Eagles unit, hungry for their second win in as many weeks. Apart from a 6-goal burst in the second quarter, the Bombers were completely swamped by the Eagles. When mid-season recruit Ryan Marich kicked this goal for the Eagles, they took a 5-point lead with less than 2 minutes remaining. It was left to Darcy Parrish, Jai Menzie, and this goal from Kyle Langford to give the Bombers a win by the barest of margins. Port Adelaide suffered their fourth loss in as many weeks when they travelled to the Cattery to take on Geelong. The first quarter was a shootout, the Power scoring 5 goals, the Cats 7, including this clever off-the-ground kick by Tyson Stengel.
Gets onto the left. The kick was intended for Frankie Evans with a Rioli looking for that goal number 5.
In the third quarter, the Power equalised and the margin was only 1 point at three-quarter time. But the Cats' cool head steadied the ship in the last quarter. This goal from Ollie Henry to Brad Close helped set up a 2-goal Cats win.
Second effort outstanding. Cameron and Jonas, one-on-one battle. Out the back, Ollie Henry to Close.
to a goal, and that might be it.
A desperate Fremantle took the game right up to Brisbane, bamboozling them in the first half of their game in Perth, and allowing the Lions to kick only three goals.
In his previous six before that, Lachie Schultz, he is back in form and gets Fremantle off to the perfect start.
With Luke Jackson dominating the ruck around the ground, the game looked to be the Dockers.
Too fast for the Lachlan. And he's got a deep bag of trap.
This ball's about to go into inside 50. Ethan Hughes is in a fair bit of trouble with the lower leg injuries, but he's had to stay out there.
They sometimes stop play as well if you stay down. In the meantime, off the handoff, McCluggage, who's missed a few this year.
But Jared Berry and Lachie Neale got the Lions going. And Eric Hipwood scored the final Lions goal to help earn them a three-point win.
Pressure on his boot. And he is up to the task.
The Pies were staring down the barrel of a third consecutive loss as they took on the Cats at the MCG. And things didn't look good for the Pies as the Cats got out to a 22-point lead early on. But the Pies took control in the second quarter and kicked away in the third. Jeremy Cameron did his best to lift the Cats, including this mark that was paid, although he appeared to be over the boundary. And as the Cats clawed their way back in the last quarter, he kicked another controversial goal. This time as Brad Close played on outside the field of play, handballing to Jeremy Cameron, who then snapped truly. Jeremy Cameron finished with 7 for the night, but the Pies won the game by 8 points. The Crows went to the Gabba to take on the Lions, who hadn't lost the game there all season. Ben Keyes and Shane McAdam got the Crows off to the perfect start, but by quarter time, Robertson and a rare goal to Harris Andrews helped the Lions take the lead. The margin was a point at half time before the Lions kicked 7 goals in the third quarter. Adelaide hit back, and when Harry Schoenberg kicked this goal, there were a chance. But the Lions repelled the Crows' attacks, and thanks to this clearing mark by Joe Danaher, they were able to hold on and win. At the MCG, while the Matildas played their World Cup quarter-final, the Blues and the Demons went blow for blow. The game was low-scoring across the first half, but the game sprang to life in the second, with 3 goals each. The teams played out an arm wrestle in the last quarter, with the Blues kicking the first 3 goals. Then the Demons hit back. But the controversy of the night belonged to this kick from Christian Petrarca, who thought he'd kicked the winning goal, only for the umpire and the arc to deny the Demons the winning goal, the Blues holding on to win by 4 points. The Hawks continued to be this season's giant killers, this time welcoming the Bulldogs down to Tasmania, and then giving them a right old walloping. Jai Newcomb was immense around the ground, while Warple and Lewis kicked important goals, and the Hawks were able to hold on for a memorable 3-point victory.
The grace of our aerial specialists is an integral part of our sporting game. The grace of our aerial specialists is famous throughout the entire sporting world. The marking and scoring an integral part of our great Australian game. These, then, are the marks for season 2023.
Zeeble!
Jack Zeeble. Nice. A little hang time there, too.
Here's his mark on the Adelaide Oval.
That is a serious grab.
Super grab. For a footballer. He can do absolutely everything.
Hands to attention and drags down a magnet.
Something to cheer about, like, for the Swans.
The Lions showed the Pies that they will be a threat come September. Brisbane player Devon Robinson was so excited he lost his shirt.
Inside 50 they go. Long deep ball. Danaher over his shoulder. He's pulled it straight over the top.
Good handball on the up, Berry. Robinson. Oh, he is in all sorts.
Oh,
and the jumper's gone. The final one was the neck brace, and look at this. We've got a top end nude out there in Robinson.
Charlie Cameron had another day out with four goals, and the big O, Oscar McInerney, stood tall in the ruck with 41 hit outs. The Tigers farewelled two of their all-time champions on Saturday, with three-time premiership captain Trent Cotchin and 787-goal champion Jack Riewoldt playing their final game for the Tigers in a 27-point win over North Melbourne.
There really is no better job in the world than playing for Richmond, and I mean, we've been lucky to do it for 16 and 17 years. We've been involved in three amazing premierships, but we've got a lifetime of memories being packed into the time we're here, and we feel so lucky to be at this football club in this family for such a long time.
With the kick, Toby Green from outside.
Every year, the battle for the finals takes on new dimensions as the season moves into August, and 2023 was no different. For Essendon and GWS, the battle for a spot in the top eight was virtually decided when the two sides met at Giant Stadium. It was one of the most lopsided matches of the year, with the Giants victorious by a record 126 points. Jesse Hogan kicked 9 goals in a very one-sided game. The Swans and the Crows played an important match at Adelaide Oval, and no call was more controversial all year than this goal line decision given late in the match. The Ben Keys kick was called a behind, and the Crows were denied both the win and a chance of playing finals. The ball clearly not touching the post as the umpire called it behind. This was the response from outgoing AFL CEO Gillon McLachlan the following morning.
I wanted to say this morning, last night, there was an umpiring decision in the final minutes of the Crow-Sydney game. There was a goal umpiring decision that should have been reviewed. And that was a mistake. I want to say conclusively that if the decision had been reviewed, it would have been overturned, and it would have been a goal.
West Coast provided the shock of the round and one of the upsets of the year when they beat the Western Bulldogs at Marvel Stadium. Jamie Cripps kicked 5 goals for the winners, and Tim Kelly provided a run around the ground, gathering 32 disposals. The loss puts the Dogs' finals hopes in doubt, while a win to the Eagles lifted them off the bottom of the ladder.
And it's going to be marriage. He could think about the joy of victory is there for this West Coast Eagles, this proud club. So soak it in.
In the final round of the season, the Magpies needed a win on Friday night over the Bombers to secure top spot. They did this with ease, kicking 8-0 in the opening term to secure their 20th minor premiership. North Melbourne fought tooth and nail to get off the bottom of the ladder, surprising an underwhelming Gold Coast Suns team down in Tasmania. The star for the Roos was Nick Larky, who finished the match with 9 goals.
Forward. Big driving ball from Stuart Lichard from Stengel, you just spoke about. Isaac Smith, one more time!
The Dogs did what they needed to do in Geelong, earning their first win at the Cattery in 20 years.
The ball surely just settles. It does in the end. Scott needs to kick the goal. DeConing gets hold of him. Handball, English, done.
They left with a hard-fought 25-point win over the Cats, earning themselves a spot in the final eight. For now.
Finish this. He does. The door was hardly ajar. He worked his way through.
They're thinking, pull the pin.
Melbourne defeated the Swans in Sydney in front of 41,000 people who came to see Buddy Franklin take a lap of honour around the SCG at halftime.
You tell me earlier, Bolts, that he's just had an amazing impact on the next generation of Sydney Swans too. A great mentor for the young players.
He has. I've spoken to the guy, likes to say Joel Amati and Logan McDonald, and they couldn't just speak more highly of the way that he's been able to just foster their
stepping path. Neat ball. Gee, that was good from Haywood. Creative, but Oliver gets...
The Demons, however, upstaged the Swans with a well-rounded performance.
Campbell couldn't get it out. Viney didn't wield his way onto the contest. Brayshaw was a chance. He liked it off the boot.
Here's Petrarca. A big goal needed. He's got it over the top. At the G. Fritsch around the corner. Does he seal it? Just about. He's kicked four.
And in the final home and away match of the year, the Giants needed to beat Carlton at Marvel Stadium to earn themselves a spot in this year's final series. Charlie Curnow kicked 2 goals early to earn himself his second successive Coleman medal. But it was all the Giants after quarter time, with both green boys, Tom and Toby, helping the Giants to a 32-point win, knocking the Dogs out of the finals, and setting up a showdown with the Saints.
So, after 24 rounds, Collingwood finished on top of the premiership ladder, followed by Brisbane, Port Adelaide, Melbourne, Carlton, St Kilda, GWS and Sydney. The Dogs falling short after a late season loss to West Coast. The stage was set for a thrilling final series.
The finals began on Thursday night, with minor premiers Collingwood taking on 4th place Melbourne at the MCG. The game was hot early on, and when Braden Maynard crashed into Demon favourite Angus Brayshaw, knocking him out, fireworks erupted.
And it's going to start a bit of a bish-bash here. Just going up to Maynard and saying, let's go, I'll stand up for my teammate here. And now it's on. This is going to erupt here. Viney and Maynard are going at it. They'll need...
The Pies were the team that settled quicker and had 4 goals on the board to the Demons' 1 and looked to be the better team. The Demons came to life after quarter time but could not kick the ball through the big sticks.
Works. You get a bit of luck out of that perhaps. An opportunity in here to Goey. 40. Closing. Long ball. Got it. What a response.
Really good. Viney. Inside 50 ball.
In the end, despite 32 more forward 50 entries, the Pies held on to win the game by 7 points.
Carlton and Sydney. Collingwood will play in the preliminary final on Craig McRae's 50th birthday.
The next night, at the same venue, Carlton looked to end a 10-year finals drought with a win over Sydney. And the Blues were up and about early, with goals to Doherty and Curnow.
Dribble along the ground.
trouble. Cottrell!
They extended their lead to 29 points by half-time. But the Swans refused to go away. Errol Goulden got the ball rolling, and they crept closer and closer to Carlton.
Parker's been busy.
While Jack Martin was huge down back in the last quarter, it was Blake Akers, one of the heroes of the night with not one but two goal line saves. He then kicked the goal that sealed Carlton's win.
Did anyone touch it?
And weren't the crowd happy?
Akers says he did.
Review complete. Looking at this angle, we can see the ball's touched by the right hand of the Carlton defender.
It gets past Campbell, 2v1 here. Surely a goal, Blues. Akers, there's your game.
I think the Blues are going to win a final. I think the Blues are home. Captain Paddy Cripps, look at this hysterical Carlton involvement. They win an epic final by 6 points.
St Kilda and GWS both had reasons to celebrate. Qualifying for finals in their first years with new coaches. The Saints got on the board early, but the Giants were able to respond quickly with their All-Australian captain, Toby Green, equalising minutes later. The Giants were able to do what few teams have done this year, putting on 8 straight goals against the usually miserly St Kilda defence, and they took control of the match. Twice St Kilda tried to mount a comeback, with the crowd behind them in voice, but both times the Giants were able to steady and kick away. The final margin, 24 points.
It's a great bond amongst the whole group. You know, we're in Sydney, where a lot of us away from our family and friends, so we just got each other, and everyone loves playing for each other.
At the Gabba, the Lions welcomed Port Adelaide in the other qualifying final, and it was clear that Port had the yips. Usually reliable Todd Marshall butchering shots on goal early on. The Lions looked to be in control but couldn't quite shake the power. In the second half, Charlie Cameron had the crowd singing with back-to-back goals in the third quarter. Joe Danaher was the hero for the Lions with 5 goals, and a hand in several others. The final margin was 48 points, the Lions earning themselves a week off.
The Lions have earned a home prelim final, and the Power have a date on Saturday night with the Giants.
At another jam-packed MCG, Melbourne and Carlton played in the cutthroat semi-final. And it was Melbourne getting out early with 3 goals and playing some irresistible football. Tom De Koning finally got the Blues on the board with 2 quick goals.
It looks good. There's their first.
In comes De Koning for second straight. Got it. And that really lifts the...
Kaziah Pickett making sure Cripps earned his free kicks with this big bump. The Blues took the lead in the second quarter, and the two teams were never separated by more than a couple of kicks. The Demon lead got out to 9 points late in the last quarter, but they couldn't convert, and they couldn't quite shake the Blues. Motlop kicked a goal to bring the margin back under a goal. And then, when Oliver and Pickett missed shots on goal, the Blues took their late opportunities. With this play launched by Jacob Wietering, the Blues went through the corridor, and it was that man again, Blake Akers, who kicked the Blues into a preliminary final. the Demons consigned to another year of straight set exits from the finals. In Adelaide, the Giants came to play, taking the game right up to the power in the first quarter. Horn Francis and Rioli's goals were matched by Green and Hogan, who were both dangerous up forward for the Giants. In the second quarter, the Giants played brave and bold football, using their speed and daring through the middle, and stunned the home crowd by piling on five straight goals. This was capped off by a 55-metre set shot bomb from Isaac Cumming. GWS left the door open for Port with six straight behinds, but the Power could only manage four of their own, as they trailed by 29 points at half-time. Zach Butters tried his best to bring the Power back into the game, but the Giants midfielders, led by Stephen Canelio, were just too strong for Port Adelaide. Riccardi and Toby Green with last quarter goals to seal another memorable road win for the Orange team.
Toby for goal number three, he's got it, and he might have just put his team into another prelim final.
Another huge crowd packed into the MCG to watch the Magpies and the Giants lock horns for a spot in the grand final. The Magpies started well, but it was the Giants who took control of the game in the second quarter. Both Tom and Toby Green helping the Giants to a 10-point lead at halftime.
It looks good. Some reward for effort for GWS.
This extended to 17 points before the Pies started to take the game on. Degoe was playing the game of his life, Giants players unable to stick a tackle. The last quarter was a dour affair, with neither side relenting. After a Mason Cox goal put the Pies ahead, Collingwood clung to a 1-point lead for the last 6 minutes of the game, including a game-saving mark from Steel Sidebottom after Toby Green's snap was online. The siren sounded, sending the Pies through to another grand final and their fans into pure rapture.
Collingwood are into the grand final. Ford McKenna watches on, little chance for Doherty to cock.
In Brisbane, the Pies started red hot and looked likely to roar straight into a grand final against arch rivals Collingwood. Carlton kicked the first 5 goals of the match to stun the Gabba crowd. The Lions kicked a late goal but still trailed by 23 points at quarter time. But the second quarter was all Brisbane as Cam Rayner got the ball moving, and Coleman and McKenna's influence on the halfback became increasingly influential. With 3-0 in the third quarter, the Lions looked to have the game won. They held Carlton at arm's length from then on to record a 16-point win and entry into the 2023 AFL Grand Final.
Actually taking
all the time in the world. Link McCarthy. Lions, Hipwood's been good. Picked up by Bailey. And it's the Brisbane Lions who meet the Magpies in the 2023 AFL Grand Final.
The Monday night before the Grand Final is traditionally set aside for the counting of votes in the Charles Brownlow Medal. Early favourites included Bulldog, Marcus Bontempelli, Collingwood's Nick Dacos, and Port Adelaide's Zach Butters.
West Coast Jay Cripps, 3 votes.
With the last round of votes to be counted, Neale and Nick Dacos held the lead. But a minute later, Bontempelli picked up 3 votes and looked to be the winner. However, Lachie Neale picked 3 votes up in the last game to finish on 31, 2 votes ahead of Marcus Bontempelli.
Brisbane. L. Neale, 3 votes. And I declare the winner of the 2023 Brownlow Medal, Lachie Neale of the Brisbane Lions Football Club.
To be amongst some of those names that have won 2 is unbelievable. In Brisbane, preparing for a grand final is amazing. So excited for what's to come this week, not only Saturday, but the build-up to the game. And I haven't been involved in this week for a decade, so I'm excited.
Well, you couldn't get a better ending to the Brownlow Medal or a more fiercely contested final series than what we've been treated to in season 2023. And then, of course, we come to that one day in September when everything stops for the AFL Grand Final. And this year, it's on Saturday, September 30. Today is that one day of the year billed as a classic confrontation between football superpowers. And what better way to end our review of the season than like this?